الله ربنا هو الإله، له من الأسماء ما اصطفاه، الواحد الحي كذا المليك، والملك المالك لا شريك، الله ربنا هو الإله.
Yeah, yeah, it is there. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم family will continue till the day of judgment, no doubt. It is there. The lineage is there. The people keep their, you know, tree of the lineage. But in India, the people claim, most of them, they claim they don't have that proof in India. Because when the Muslim governments were there, they used to give extra importance to the Sayyid family. So these people, they started claiming that we are Sayyid in India. Otherwise, there are the families are there.
They must have the family tree.
They must have the family tree, yes. They should prove. King of Jordan is from the family of the Prophet ﷺ, and King of Maghrib is from the family of the Prophet ﷺ. Abul Hasan Ali Nadwi is the from the family of the Prophet ﷺ. These people have the, you know, the tree of the lineage.
The normal
thing
is in Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, or
so.
Yeah, it's a title. Yeah, it is. Yeah, just they claim. Yes.
Yeah,
it is right now due to the secularism, due to the awareness, Sayyid people don't have extra, you know, importance. Otherwise, if you go back for 50 years, 70 years, Sayyid means the person who is, you know, mediator between the common public and between Allah, Subhanahu wa Taala. He should be like a Brahman. He is only, you know, taking all the religious, you know, activities, and he is making dua for the people. Nothing should happen except by his permission. When he died, his grave become, you know, itself a place of worship, important. That is always the Sayyid. So that is why you will see, if you go to, suppose in the south of Tamil Nadu, very far away, in Kanyakumari, Karaikal, that you will see the on the Dargah, you know, Bukhari, Naqshbandi, Sayyid Fulan. So they came from the Bukhara. They came from, you know, Russian areas, Iran and that areas. But these people, for Sayyid, they came for the Dawah, for, you know, teaching Islam. When they die, they become Dargah. And their incest, you know, their generation, these people also marketed it, and they earning the money by this Dargah. But you will not see any Dargah without Sayyid family. All the Dargahs, whether it is a small one or the big one. So, did you get it? That is, you know,
yeah?
People made them after they died, or in their lifetime also they were marketing themselves. Why not? They were marketing. It was easy money to get the position. So they were telling, we are Sayyid, so we cure you. You come to us. You prostrate to us, kiss our legs, and, you know, give the nazrana. Nazrana means give the money. So that was happening in their lifetimes also. Aywa. And these, you know, these.
No, a car, now 9950 is blocking some maintenance work which is happening inside the campus. 9950.
So, these people, they used to market it, and Shia was behind it. That is why you will see a, you know, huge, you know, influence of the Shia on those people who are claiming Dargah people, that is the Barelvi people. Because the Shia was the first one who introduced the grave worship and the tombs and, you know, huge places for worshipping other than Allah. The first, this idea, you know, introduced by the Shia among the Muslim Ummah. So that is why you will see everywhere where there is a Dargah, these people, whether they are Shia or all the, you know, influence of the Shia they have in their ideology. So it is a huge relation between the Dargah people and between the Shia. So who introduced the grave worship and the building of, about the graves and the tombs among Muslim Ummah in the 4th century, it is the first the Shia they introduced. And later on they used for themselves and for the other people they created. So the Sufism and the Dargah people, they have, you know, common things more with the Shia than the Sunni people. That is why when the matter of Tawheed and truth it comes, the Badalwis and the Murshid and the Sufis, they go with the Shias and they become one hand against the Sunnis everywhere in the history.
Can the Sayyids be called as Muslim Brahmins in their traditions?
We can't say Muslim Brahmins, but we gave the example as the Brahmins in the Hinduism, they call themselves that they are upper caste and all the people, they subject them. Similarly, that environment they created in Sayyid and the Shias and the Dargah people, they created among the Muslims. Similarities are there. Okay, brothers? Where are we? We finish it?
Yeah.
Okay, let us go to the next topic.
Chapter number 16, what the Lord has said. Allah the most exalted said, حَتَّى إِذَا فُزِّيَ أَلْ قُلُوبِهِمْ قَالُوا مَاذَا قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ قَالُوا الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْكَبِيرُ. Until when fear is
bad. See here, this verse is related to when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks for revelation, to wahi. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, so Jibreel takes it and then it brought down to the messengers, isn't it? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, what happened for the angels? You know that angels are not like human beings. Some of the angels are, physical greatness and their power, sometimes you can't imagine, isn't it? Because some angels, they came to Lut alayhi salam's, village or the city. They took it and they turned it upside down. So any human being can do that? All the human beings with this technology also? So this is a power. In some milliseconds, these people go to the humans and they come back. And the Prophet ﷺ informed that those angels who are carrying the throne, the Prophet said, Udhin Ali, it is allowed me, it is permitted to me to inform about the angels of carriers of the throne, that the distance between their ear and their shoulders is 700 years off. Yeah, the distance. So if someone walk and fly, so it is 700. So huge, we can't imagine. Those people, what happened the situation when they hear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah's voice, let us see.
Until when fear is banished from their hearts, they say, what is it that your God has said? They say, the throne, that is the most high, the most great.
So when Allah speaks, fear. They are not able to understand. They are not able, they are shivering. It's okay. Then the fear disappears. They ask what the Lord said. So go ahead, read the hadith. The situation becomes more clear. Okay, read the hadith.
And in Sahih al-Bukhari, it is reported that Abu Hurairah narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when Allah decrees some order in the heaven, the angels...
When Allah decrees some order, He speaks, He orders, in the heavens,
the angels flutter their wings, indicating complete surrender to His saying.
So they move their wings, surrendering to the Allah's order.
It sounds like chains being dragged on rock. And when the state of fear is banished from their
heart. When the state of fear, so they are fearing from the, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, orders, fear.
They say, what is that your Lord has said? They say, the throne, and He is the most high, the most great. Then the stealthy listeners hear this order.
So here, stealthy listeners means the satans. Before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can imagine the importance of Islam, importance of Wahi. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala block all the satans from visiting the heavens, lower heaven. So these people, they astonish. What is happening? It never happened. throughout the history, something is strange. So they started roaming in the earth to see when the Prophet ﷺ was reciting the Quran. So that's why we didn't hear such a pure, important, righteous, truth words. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to protect the Quran, He blocked the doors, or blocked the ways on the nearest heaven. And then when He sends the message, لِيَعْلَمَ قَدْ أَبْلَغُوا رِسَالَاتُ رَبِّهِمْ وَأَحَاطَ بِمَا لَدَيْهِمْ وَأَحْصَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ عَدَدًا عالم الغيب فلا يظهر على غيبه احدا الا من ارتضى من رسول فانه يسلك من بين يديه ومن خلفه رصدا. When the message is coming, so there is the protector, God, front and behind. Jibril is bringing the message. No one can. Then it came to the Prophet ﷺ. So from the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the responsibility goes to the Muslim Ummah. Till this, here, it was the responsibility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it came to the Prophet, then the responsibility goes to Muslim Ummah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to make and keep it pure. So if you read the history of Sahaba, Tabi'een, Ulama, Muhaddithin, Mufassirin, how they protect every word, every action, every Arabic, you know, word which is used or the in the Arabic language, all they spent, you know, they dedicated all their lives, hundreds of the people, thousands of the people. So it is, they, you know, they protected the words of Allah, speech of Allah, and explanation of the Quran by the Prophet ﷺ. They kept it as it is. Did you get, brother? Did you get it? So this is the importance of Islam and Deen, and it will remain till the Day of Judgment. So people claiming that we can add, it is changed, it is fabricated, that and this, it is not so simple. They don't have the knowledge. One of a person in the history, he used to fabricate. He was a Rafidi, Shia, Al-Maslub. See, he fabricated, daily he fabricated some hadith and he, you know, spread among the Muslim Ummah. When the Muslim authorities, they caught him, they brought him to kill. So he said, it's okay, you will kill me, but more than 4,000 fabricated ahadith I have spread Muslim Ummah, what do you do about it? So the authorities said, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created to check it, people like Ahmad bin Hanbal and others. So they will take care of your fabrication, then he killed him. So it is reality. So these people, they search, who said, when said, why said, where said. So they said it is fabricated. This person, not authentic. So all this they wrote. So it's the filtration, they did it. So anyway, my point is that, though we are, you know, studying the subject of Tawheed, but I wanted to show you the, you know, protection of our Deen, the purity of our Deen also there. Because the people don't know, they claim, easy going, become Islam and the fatwa and the deen become very easy. These people, they dedicated whole lives and still at the end they say, we don't know. But these people, they don't know anything, but they claim we know everything. That is the speakers of this time. Okay? So they take the Quran and they take the Hadith. Quran and Hadith, you know, we can understand. That's it, finish. How do you understand?
See, from the Hadith, that one prayer Ramshari
is equal to 1 lakh prayers. So the Tamil Jama,
they have, I heard it in the budget, that if you give 1 riyal, it's equal to 1 lakh riyal. If you fast one day, it's equal to 1 lakh fast.
Where?
In Makkah? Yes. Then Tamil Jama, they were reading from the book, is the first they said, if you make 1 rakah, that is equal to 1 lakh in Ramshari. Then the next, they said in the next day, if you fast one day in Haram Sharif, it's equal to 1 lakh fast. If you give 1 riyal in Haram Sharif, you'll do 1 lakh riyal.
It is wrong. Right. Because it is a deen, we should not say something about the deen, in the deen. So whatever the Prophet said, we have to accept it. And we have to go back to the Sahaba, whether they said this and they understood it not. So why we are? To, you know, introduce something.
They are saying
It is wrong, 100% wrong. 100% wrong. So anyway, so angels, they scare, they keep quiet. Then they ask each other, what Allah said? Okay, go ahead. So, Mustariqussam. Who is the Mustariqussam? It is in the hadith itself. Go ahead.
Then the stealthy listeners came hear this order, and these stealthy listeners are like this, one over the other. Sufyan, a sub-narrator, demonstrated that by holding his hand upright and separating the fingers.
Yeah, like this. So he said, explain. So they are connected each other till that, because if they listen, he pass speedily. Otherwise, Shihabun Thaqib. Shihabun Thaqib is?
Shooting
star will catch him. Okay.
A stealthy listener hears about which he will convey to that which is below him, and the second will convey it to the human.
So this is the way. He conveys to him, he conveys. So one word they hear and they convey. Not whole message, only one. Among the complete message, they hear
spot.
One word, one spot. It's okay.
Till the last of them will convey it to the wizard of fortune. Sometimes
Sahir, Lisan is Sahiri Avil Kahin, magician or fortune teller. No magician is there?
Wizard.
That's okay.
Sometimes a flame may strike the devil before he can convey it, and sometimes he may convey it before the flame strikes him. Whereupon the wizard adds to that word 100 lies.
So one truth, 100 lies. Okay? Go ahead.
The people will then say, didn't the magician tell such things?
So the one truth they are narrating, and they are remembering, and they are teaching, and they are influencing the people. 99 lies, they forget it. They don't remember it. They don't narrate it. So if they narrate the 99 lies, that means they don't have to depend on him. They will not go to him. They will not ask him. They will not visit him at all. So can you imagine, the human beings are very fast in falsehood. Isn't it very fond of falsehood? The truth is difficult for them. So 99 they ignore. The one they highlight always. Oh, mashallah, mashallah. See here, he knows, he informs, he does what he says is true always. So that is making the problem. Go ahead.
Didn't the magician tell such and such a thing on such and such day? So that magician is said to have told the truth because of the statement which has been heard from the heavens.
So this is the hadith. One hadith. We explain a little bit hadith. We will take some points from when the Muhammad bin Abdullah himself, he highlights some issues. So the next hadith is, and in Nawas ibn Sam'an,
that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when Allah wishes to reveal something to man, he speaks out of the words to be revealed. At this, the heavens shake strongly in fear of him. When the words of Allah fall upon the inhabitants of heaven, they are taken back, they are taken by shock and fall prostrate. The first of them to raise his head is the angel Jibreel.
So when Allah speaks, all of them fell down in the prostration. So huge creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, greatest creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, physical. Jibreel alayhi salam, so powerful that the east and west were filled by his physical appearance. It is in the hadith, Sahih Bukhari. So these people, such a huge people, they feel they are weak, they are nothing in front of Allah. So what about the human being 5 feet? But this human being are tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
The first of them to raise his head is the angel Jibreel, whom Allah speaks out of the revelation what he wishes. Then Jibreel passes by the other angels in different heavens and is asked at each station, what did our Lord say, O Jibreel? He answers, he said the truth. He is most high, the most great, and all repeat the same after him. Then Jibreel moves on to the destination with the revelation to where commanded by Allah the most high.
So this is the way. Okay. So Jibreel alayhi salam, though he was a so great angel, so powerful, when Allah speaks, they fell down. So what the human being? That is the comparison that Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab rahmatullah alayhi want to teach, want to give the people. Oh people, you are nothing. You are nothing comparing to angels. But these angels, they know the reality. Allah's words he speaks. When he speaks, come, they fell down. And they don't hear due to the scare and fear. They ask Jibreel then, what Allah said. So he said, Al-Haq, because it is truth. And they also repeat, yes, he speaks only truth. Okay? So what is the important issues Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab rahmatullah alayhi deduced from these two hadith and one verse? Let us see.
Explanation of the verse 34 is 23. In this verse is a proof for the invalidation of shirk, especially regarding what is attached to those righteous people, that is of the supplication of the ignorant towards them. It is said that this verse cuts the roots of the tree of shirk in the heart.
First, you know, Tafsirul Ayah. What is the tafsir al-ayah? What is the point? حَتَّى إِذَا فُزِّعَ عَنْ قُلُوبِهِمْ قَالُوا مَاذَا قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ قَالُوا الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْكَبِيرُ. Brother, you are reading the same issue or same what else? The second one also you read it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Why did you read the second one? So first one is about the angels and their situation, which we explain while we are explaining the words. Is it clear? So okay, next one is Muhammad bin Abdul Wahab is telling that it, you know, root out all the basics of the shirk. How it roots out? Let us see what it is there in the verse. Al-Malaika, angels, though they are more powerful than the human being, they don't have any power. Huh? Isn't it? So when there is no power, then why you are going to ask them, depend on them, take them as the mediator? So there is no power, don't ask. That is rooting out of the shirk. Finish. Okay? Isn't it? Then the la yamlikuna shay'an, they don't have any power. First, they don't have any authority. The next is any authority. So there is no authority at all. So if anyone does not have the authority, what does it mean? Depending on asking him, visiting him, something. So if the angel, Jibreel, most important creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't have any authority, don't have any power. Okay? And the previous verses also shows the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he does not have the power, he does not have the authority. That is what Allah said. Okay, number third,
explanation of Allah's words.
No. This, yeah, third point. Okay.
Explanation of Allah's words. قَالُ الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْكَبِيرُ. They say the truth and He is the most high, the most great.
So all the angels, they repeat, Al-Haqq. قَالَ الْحَقَّ. Allah said the truth. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ. And He is the highest one. So Prophet Muhammad bin Abdullah rahmatullah alayhi, by mentioning this words, he is telling that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken, whether it is in the Quran or through the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it must be 100% truth without any doubt. So what they said always is, always they call for the tawheed, whole Quran, depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is the truth, isn't it? Why?
Why not Salamullahul Azim also can be said?
Sunnah is with the Prophet, the Sahaba, they used to recite the Quran, but they did not say at the end Sadaqallahul Azim. That is why we should not say.
But this can be said.
Qala al-Haq.
Yeah, because
So that is the angel said it. If you are asked, then you said it. Otherwise, you don't make a practice and the habit. Don't make the practice or the habit. That is why sometimes you will see the scholars, sometimes the Sahaba, Sadaqallahu wa Rasulu, they used to say it sometimes. But not only for the Quran. Whenever it is recited, they used to say something. See here, one of the criteria of the bid'ah, actions was existing at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, actions, or the situations were existing, and there was no impedimentation. That means, impedimentation means mane. Mane means there was nothing to prevent them from doing, and they did not do. Did you understand? There was the necessity, requirement, but they did not do. And for not doing, there was no any impedimentation. Stopping them anything.
Impediment.
So we should not do that. For example, Kaaba. Okay. The Prophet's, let's say Kaaba, it may be confusing. Suppose writing the Quran in the one book or printing the Quran. Okay. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time, he can write the book in one book, but he did not do that. Why he did not do that? There was some reason that the Quran is continuously revealing. Isn't it? So that's why he did not do that. Abu Bakr did that. Why? It is completed. So what Abu Bakr did is not against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Continuous prayer of Tarawih. The Prophet did it 2 days, 3 days. Then there was some impediment stopping him, that it may become further. So he stopped it. When he died, that's over. That comes on. Isn't it, brother? So Prophet ﷺ and Sahaba, due to some impediment, he did not do it. So after that, we can do that because he wanted, he wished, and he, you know, it is the fulfilling the purpose of the Prophet ﷺ or the deen. Miladun Nabi, for example. Anything was impediment or stopping the Prophet and the Sahaba from celebrating the Miladun Nabi? No. And loving and respecting was there, like we are claiming. And they love more than us, respect more than us. Then still they did not do that. So why? Because they understood automatically it is not the part of the love, and what we are doing is may go against the statement and the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ celebration. So they did not do that. So right now we should not do that. Did you get it? So Prophet and Sahaba, they used to recite the Quran always in the gatherings, in the individual, you know, recitation. And nobody was, and nothing impediment was there to say Sadaqallahu Lazim. But they did not do that. So we should not do that. That is the bid'ah. So if there is, you know, necessity, requirement was there at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, still they did not do that, we should not do that. If there was impediment, that is why they did not do that, after removal of that impediment, it has become allowed to do that. So this is one of the, you know, understanding of the bid'ah. People are confused due to not having why the Prophet did not do, why the Umar do. So these things we should make the principle and then we understand the situation. Why Umar did it? If you see whatever Umar did is, it does not go against the what the Prophet ﷺ did it. If the situation of the Prophet ﷺ as the situation of Umar, he would have done it. Okay? Is it clear, brother? Go ahead. So you people are asking about the bid'ah and about this, our book, our subject is about Tawheed. So people talk about everything, they don't talk about Tawheed. That is why I always say in my lectures or sometime, if you ask someone to talk about any subject, he may talk 10, 20 minutes, 1 hour. But if you ask him to talk about Allah, the Creator, it is difficult for them to talk. Because there is no concept and no subject of Tawheed which is taught and is spread in Muslim Ummah in India. They don't talk about Tawheed, about La ilaha illallah. You see here, right now we are jumping and we are rushing. Otherwise we can stop for one subject a whole day. One subject, whatever it is. lastalaka min al-amri shay. O Prophet, you don't have any authority and power. So we can explain the position of the Prophet, his virtues, his sacrifice, his position, what Allah granted him. Then still, the people of his family, his cousins, his followers were killed. And he's making dua about them. So Allah said, who are you? So we can explain whole day. And then we can compare in our situation. We are doing very simple little things. Then still we are hoping that why the wars, success is not coming. Why the Muslims are bad, weak, and others are powerful. They are not powerful. We are weak. We are not following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise Allah wants to help. That's it. So it's Tawheed, the most forgotten, neglected subject. Isn't it? That is, you will see, go to the markets, society, streets, they always fight how to move the finger, where to have to move the finger, you wear the topi or not. That is the fight. Important subject, Aqeedah, Tawheed, they have forgotten it. They don't know who is Shia. They don't know who is Bohra. They don't know what is Kuffar. Who are Kuffar? Who are Jews? Subhanallah. So that is why their enmity to a Sunni, to a Salafi, to a Hanafi is more than enmity of Ram, Lakshman, Shia. This, it is the reality of society, brothers. Isn't it? Yeah. That is the Satan. Because we did not understand the principle of the Deen. We did not understand the importance of the Tawheed. It's okay? So, bidah, all these things we can start once again. Right now, let us in the Tawheed. Okay.
The reason for I was asking about that was...
What? Which one? Which point? Fourth point.
The reason for the question about that was...
The reason of question. Angels, why they are asking when Allah spoke? So why they are asking what Allah said? Allah spoke, they have heard it. Why they ask? Because due to the fear, scale, they were not able to capture it. Then they asked Jibreel alayhi salam. So it's showing their fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what he want to say. That the huge, powerful people, that is the angels, I told you, that they can come in seconds, in milliseconds to the earth. They can take the village of Lut alayhi salam in some seconds up to the heaven. They can turn upside down. Such people, when they are in front of Allah, fearing. So that fear is the part of Iman. So we should not depend that we have Sadat family, Sayyid family, we have the contact relation, we have performed. I told you, we grow the beard, we are doing dawah, we have a center and khalas, mashallah, safe. That the Sahaba, they felt it. Umar radiallahu anhu, when he was going to die, Ali radiallahu anhu came. He said, don't worry. I always used to hear the Prophet. I believe, Abu Bakr believed. And Umar believed. I entered, Abu Bakr entered, Umar entered, I went out, Abu Bakr went out, Umar went out, always. So what he said? Umar cried. He said, I want that maximum my wishes, and yakuna kafafan la liya wala aliya. All whatever it is did, it should be equal. Not in my favor or against me, my actions. Yeah, kafafan alayya means it should not be against him, it should not be in favor. Equal. Equal means, does not take him to the paradise, does not take him to hellfire. Let him to be not be punished and not be favor. That is what he wished. I used to hear the Prophet ﷺ that always mentioning you with him. I believed, and Abu Bakr and Umar believed. I did, Abu Bakr and Umar did. So he was with the Prophet. So he was counseling him. So that time he said. So fear. So angels fear. That is Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahmatullah alayhi want to show the people, oh people, don't depend on you. Relations, positions, lineage, family, it's on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like the angels. Okay.
The Jibreel alayhi salam answered their question after the Prophet's words. He said such and such.
Hmm.
The description of the fact.
One second. So because Jibril is responsible for the wahi, he reads and he informs the people that what Allah says. Okay? Hmm.
The description of the fact that Jibril alayhi salam was the first to raise his head to attend to the revelation of Allah.
Aywa. So Jibril was the first one who raised hands and who attended. Okay, go ahead.
Unconsciousness occurs to all the dwellers of the heavens.
Jibril
alayhi salam answers to all angels of the heavens for the all questioning.
Yeah. A kind of, you know, unconsciousness. Sa'iqo is not complete unconscious, complete shock. When a person is completely shocked, what happens, you know, sometimes for some moment it is not difficult to, you know, to grasp what is happening nearby. So that is the shock, sa'iqu. Sa'iqu means complete shock. So due to the fear, they come in a complete shock, then they ask Jibreel alayhi salam in an inform. So okay, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay.
Unconsciousness occurs to all the dwellers of the heavens.
Subhanallah.
Trembling of the heavens due to the words of Allah.
Aywa. Even the heavens, the Shiva, due to the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why Kalamullah, the Quran, is so respectful. We should have that respect. Speech. It is not one word, it is holy speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So angels, when Allah speaks, so they fear, they scared. The heavens, the Shiva. So this is the speech of Quran. The speech of Allah is this Quran. لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصديا من خشية الله. So really the Quran has a, you know, lot of power. It's okay?
That Jibreel alayhi salam is the one who conveys the revelation to wherever Allah commands.
So Jibreel, he conveyed the message, wahi, no one else. That is why all the angels, they ask Jibreel whenever he passed by all the heavens.
He is dropping off heavenly discussion by devils.
What?
Ears dropping.
The satans, they listen secretly. They steal. Okay? They listen. So that happens. Okay?
State of
standing
of seals atop
of one another. So how they stand, that it is made clear. Okay.
Falling down of shooting stars.
Shooting stars fall on them. Yes, it is true. It is mentioned in the Quran. فَأَتْبَعْهُ شِهَابٌ ثَاقِبٌ. It is in the Quran. وَجَعَلْنَاهَا رُجُومًا لِلشَّيَاطِينِ. رُجُومًا. You know, the stars, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them as the rujum.
The shooting star sometimes hits the devil before he conveys the stolen message, and sometimes he reaches the ear of his human friend before he is struck.
So before striking him, it pass. One word.
Sometimes the soothsayer may relay the truth.
The soothsayer, if the people they think that he has said truth, he has spoken truth, that means maybe 1% is there, the truth is there, no doubt about it. But it does not mean that we have to accept him, we have to visit him, we have to depend on him, we have to make him as having the divine powers. No. He has something taken from somewhere. No divine powers. No extra ordinary powers. Okay.
The soothsayer mixes the truth with the
hundred lies. Aywa. The soothsayer, that means it is a principle. That whenever you visit or whenever you see someone who is a soothsayer, who is talking about the unseen matters, who is the soothsayer? The person who tells about the future, forecast the incidents. That is the soothsayer. So these people always they are the liars. That means always they are the liars. Maybe some 1% truth is there, but it does not mean that we have to accept them or we have to approve them. Mm.
His lies are not believed except for the word of truth which was heard from heaven.
So in those lies, what is heard from the heaven, that is truth. Otherwise, all are lies. Or sometimes there is no 1% even truth. Mm.
The acceptance of falsehood by the human nature, how they hang on to one truth and not consider the 100 lies.
It is clear, isn't it? So they always talk about one truth and they neglect 100 lies.
How they pass the word to one another, memorize it and use it as evidence for other lies.
So that one truth, they memorize, they attach, they depend, they spread, but they neglect the 99 of them, or the falsehood. Okay.
Affirmation of the divine attributes of Allah in opposition to demands of the Ashariya and
Mu'tazila. Hmm. Here we need a complete lecture once again. Due to the, you know, Greek influence and due to the rationalism, people started involving in the matters which is above their intellect, above their ability, and they confuse. Because if it is related to the seen matter, somehow they can try. But they started thinking and taking the decision about unseen matters. And they made the mistakes. And when they made the mistake, because generally the genius, intellectual people, they think about this matter, the philosophers, they come up with some philosophy, so people accept them, so it become a group. Okay? So, in the Muslim Ummah also, there are the groups. One of the group is Al-Ash'ari. His founder was Abul Hasan Al-Ash'ari. These people, they are not able to think about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they confuse. They say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, the human being loves. So how the Allah's loves is, you know, how Allah will share an attribute which is like human being. So human being have the love, human being have the angry, human being speaks. So Allah should be different from them because nothing is like Allah. So they said Allah does not speak, Allah does not love. Finish. So what about the verses in the Quran and the Hadith? So they misinterpret it. Love means that Allah want to, you know, give them the reward on the day of judgment. Anger means Allah want to punish them. This way they interpreted it. Okay? Ta'wil. Ta'wil is sifat. Ta'wil means misinterpretation. Misinterpretation means they interpret it, but not according to the real linguistic meaning or according to what the Sahaba they said. Do you understand, brother? So this is the problem of many people in Muslim Ummah.
Please repeat this.
Yeah, I told you that attributes, it is a huge topic, but these people rationally they try. So they thought that human being also share the same attributes. So Allah is not like the human being, so they deny from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say Allah does not have these attributes. So what about it is in the Quran and Hadith? They misinterpret it. For example, Allah loves, they say not, it is not the law which we have the law. It is that Allah want to give them the reward. So that is why it is not law.
It's like Yadullah.
Yadullah also.
They say it's power, not
power. Yadullah means not the hand, it is the power. Allah has the power, no hand. What it is, Yad means it is the power in the Quran. So by this way they misinterpret it. Okay? So it is not the way of the Sahaba. Sahaba is one Allah alayhi majma'in, they did not say that yuhibbuhum wa yuhibbuna. that when Allah said the hubbun and Allah said angry, they did not say reward and they did not say punishment. So why we have to say? Why these people they say? Because they were not able to cope up with their mentality, because they were rationally thinking. So that is why they say some people, these people, they misinterpreted it, ta'wil. Some people, they denied it, say there are no attributes for Allah at all. Denying. Because they deny, that is mu'attila. Mu'attila means denying. And Allah is without any attribute. Yeah. Lot of things are there. And they said, also, tawheed means you deny attributes of Allah. Why? If you say Allah, then Rahman, Rahim, Kareem, so it are many Allahs. That also, they thought it. They say Allah. Yeah, Allah, Rahman, Rahim, Kareem, that means many Allahs. Or it gives, you know, chance of many Allahs. So they say Allah, no attributes at all. Nafyus sifat. They deny all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mu'attila. Mu'attila means denying. Ash'ari, they misinterpret. And there are not only Ash'ari, there are other groups also there. But Ash'ari is more common among the Muslim Ummah. 80%, 90% Muslim Ummah is Ash'aris. So that is why he pointed out the Ash'aris. He said that these people are wrong. Otherwise, there are Mu'tazila, there is Kullabiyya, there is Maturidiyya. Lot of people are there, isn't it? Is it clear, brothers? Okay.
The trembling and shaking of the heavens is due to the fear of Allah the Almighty.
So this hadith also shows that the angels, that the heaven, they fear. The heaven also fear. So all the creatures, they have, you know, fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it suits their creatures. So suppose, for the example, there is a hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took, you know, some pebbles in his hand, and he said that I know that they are glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't know how they are glorifying, but Allah created them so to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isn't it? So similarly, the heavens, they are fearing. They are shivering from the fear. So it happens. Every creature, they submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ma fi samawati wal ard, whatever it is, the universe, it submit to Allah. Except the human being, which is, you know, they are ordered to do that. Okay.
Angels fall down in prostration for Allah.
For Allah only. Okay. Let us go ahead.
Chapter number 17, the intercession. Allah.
Intercession. Shafa'ah. Intercession. So it is very misunderstood, you know, topic among Muslims, among non-Muslims also. Among non-Muslims, they made, you know, certain deities, certain, you know, certain people, certain righteous people, or some creatures as the intercessor between them and between Allah. So they worship them. They worship Buddha or the, you know, idols somewhere, because they are manifestation of the God. Okay? And it is misunderstood among Muslims also. They say that we, like Christians, they make the mistakes and they believe that their pops or their fathers, they can intercede and then take them the forgiveness, isn't it? Similarly, Muslims, we have their murshids, their leaders, or, you know, their families, you know, highest level of the family, Sayyid family, due to that Allah will forgive them. So these are, you know, shafa, everywhere it is misinterpreted and misunderstood. Okay, let us see. Shafa is there in the Quran and the Hadith, but not as this shafa which is commonly, you know, exists among the society, whether it is Muslims or not. There is the true shafa that happens, but they have the condition. Let us see if we understand it.
وأنذر به الذين يخافون
أن يحشروا إلى ربهم
ليس لهم من دونه ولي ولا شفيع لعلهم يتقون.
وأنذر به الذين يخافون أن يحشروا إلى ربهم ليس لهم من دونه ولي ولا شفيع لعلهم يتقون. Read the translation.
I warn them with those who fear that they will be gathered before their Lord, when there will neither be a protector nor an intercessor for them besides Him, so that they may fear Allah and keep their duty to Him.
There you are. No intercessor. Anzir bihi alladhina. Warn them. Okay. Then another words.
Qul lillahi shafa'atu jami'a. Say to Allah belongs all intercession.
All intercession is in the hands of Allah, in the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No intercession. All the intercession is Allah, in Allah's power. So if it is in Allah's power, Allah can grant someone. Okay.
Who is he that can intercede with him except with his permission?
Who can intercede except with his permission? It's okay, accept his permission. It's okay.
وَكَمْ مِنْ
مَلَكٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ
لَا تُغْنِي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ يَأْذَنَ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرَى اللَّهُ. And there are many angels in the heavens whose intercession will avail nothing except after Allah has given leave, for whom evil set pleases.
See here, this is important. إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرْضَى. After Allah give the permission for whom He likes and He is pleases with them. He owns the shafa'ah. No one can do except with her permission. That permission is granted to whom He pleases. Did you get it? In the sequence of the verses? If Allah does not like someone, nobody will intercede for him. Because Allah will allow them to intercede for whom He likes. مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مَا لَهُمْ فِيهِمَا مِنْ شِرْكٍ وَمَا لَهُ مِنْهُمْ مِنْ ظَهِيرٍ وَلَا تَنْفَعُ الشَّفَاعَةُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا لِمَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ.
Say, call upon those whom you accept to be associate gods besides Allah. They possess not even the weight of an atom.
They don't possess.
Or a small ant, either in the heavens or on the earth. Nor have they any share in either. Nor there is for him any supporter from among them. Intercession with him profits not, except for him whom he permits.
Okay. Read.
Abu Abbas said that
it is not hadith. Qala Abu Abbas. It is Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh. Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh. What he said after these verses, read his. He explained
it. He said that Allah has equally negated all that the Muslims have attached to that false god.
See, Allah equally negated for everything that Mushrikeen, whether it is among the Muslims or the non-Muslims, they attach. It's okay. They say, what we are doing is the shafa. Allah said, shafa Allah owns. So you don't do that. When they commit the shirk, they say, we are not worshipping them. Rather, we are taking them as the intercessor. So who are you to take the intercessor? Intercessors. Allah did not allow you. So these verses, basically negating all those means and evidences on which the mushrikeen depend. Okay, so let us see. How? Fanafa.
For he has negated that anyone has any dominion or any share of him besides him.
So no power, no domain. So no one has the domain. So no one has the power of the intercession. First.
Or that there is any assistance to Allah.
No assistance for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. So if there is no assistance, what happened, you know? A king is there, the assistant is there. So if the assistant is there, so he can intercede the people. There is no assistant for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How anyone can intercede?
And or that there is any other Satvala, and that there is nothing to remain except intercession, it is clear that there will be no benefit to anyone except for who has been granted permission by the Lord.
So first, you know, we have to think about whether Allah likes us or not, so that He can allow someone to intercede for us, so that we don't know. So it is, you know, He negated and, you know, root out all the types of the shirk.
They will not be able to intercede except for Him with whom He is pleased. And for this reason, the intercession that the Mushrikeen believe in is rejected on the day of resurrection, as it is rejected by the Quran and as the Prophet informed us. He will come and prostrate to his Lord and praise him, and he will not begin with intercession at first.
So even the Prophet, right now he is mentioning about the Prophet on the day of judgment, the people will be in the, you know, in the, you know, Maidanul open land, Hashar, yes. All the people is gathered in an open land, that is the Hashar, and they are, you know, under the sun, not having any shelter and no shade, and they are very thirsty and very bad situation. Sun is nearby their heads, so a lot of, you know, difficulties are there. In this situation, they are, you know, they have spent a lot of time, years. So they want that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at least start their accounting. Okay? So they went to Adam, to Noah, to Ibrahim, to all the messengers. So they say, no, today Allah becomes so angry, He was never before. So we are not there to go to ask, to make dua for something, isn't it? So then they come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam goes to Allah, He fell down in the sajda. Fell down. So it is not that, O Prophet, make the intercession, no. Then Allah ordered him, raise your head. Irfa rasak. O Muhammad, Ya Muhammad, irfa rasak. Raise your head. Sal, tu'ta, ask, I will give you. Washfa, tushafa. And then make intercession, I will accept it. Did you get it? So no power. So even the best one, the one who is able to go to Allah, he does not do the intercession by himself. He fell down in the prostration. Then Allah will ask him and order him to do something, then he will do.
It's true that when Rasul will fall in prostration, he will praise Allah that which he did not know, which Allah will teach.
Yes, it is in Sahih Bukhari, yes. That is why this situation is called Maqame Mahmud, the place of Mahmud. Because the Prophet said, I praise Allah with the words and with the praises which I never did, and that Allah inspired me that time, and I will do that. Maqame Mahmud.
And there is not told before.
Yeah, it is not told before. Okay.
It will be said afterwards, raise your head, speak, and it will be heard. Ask, and you will be given. Intercede, and intercession will be granted.
So did you understand? The point is that no one dare to do the intercession, and no one has the power, and no one can do for anyone he wants. So, yeah.
Abu Hurairah asked the Prophet, who will be the happiest of people with your intercession?
So right now, Prophet do the intercession after the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for whom he, Allah has pleased from whom, isn't it? So another hadith, Abu Huraira asked, O Prophet, who gets your intercession? Who is eligible for that? So see the hadith.
Who will be the happiest of people with your intercession? He, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, whoever said, La ilaha illallah, sincerely, with pure intention from his heart.
Subhanallah. So those people who get the intercession is who did not commit the khalisam min qalbi, la ilaha illallah, purely from the bottom of the heart, means no shirk. La ilaha illallah is no shirk. This is what he wants to explain it. Okay. Did you understand the importance of this book right now?
Yes.
Did you understand the importance of the book?
Success. You don't understand this, there's no success.
Yeah, no, subhanAllah, though it is a simple things, but how he was able to clarify the tawheed and the doubts.
But directly reading it, we can't understand.
Yes.
Directly reading the book of our own, we can't really understand.
So you need the teacher. Good, alhamdulillah.
Not the internet.
So if you read directly, it is difficult to understand. You cannot imagine the importance of that. With the help of the teacher, okay.
So this intercession is for those people with pure intent. If Allah so wills, and it will not be for those who commit shirk.
Mm.
The essence of
so no intercession for those who commit the shirk, it is a simple thing. Mm.
The essence of the matter is that it is Allah who is above all imperfections, who favors the people sincere in the worship, and forgives them through the medium of the invocation of whoever he has given permission to intercede as an honor to him and to confer upon him the highest place, al-maqam al-mahmud.
Aywa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if somebody will ask why, where, all these things, so Allah wanted to give that position to the Prophet ﷺ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes the people, but they have some mistakes. So Allah wanted to make a favor, but not directly. So in that time, He wanted to honor the Prophet by accepting and allowing him the intercession. And at the same time, He wanted to make a favor on the believers who had made mistakes. So that is why He allowed them this intercession. Okay, that is what he is telling. So that position of the Prophet of asking Allah to start the accounting, which no one was able to ask Allah, that is the highest position of praising Allah. That is why it is called position of Mahmud, Maqame Mahmud. That is, we ask Allahumma ati Muhammadan al-wasila wal-fadila wa ba'athu Maqame Mahmuda alladhi wa'atta.
The intercession which is rejected and denied in the Quran is that which involves shirk.
Shirk. You are asking someone directly. You are believing that anyone can do for anyone, anytime. So all these things is the shirk intercession that should not be believed. It is denied by the Quran. Hmm.
And this is why intercession is confirmed and affirmed by the permission of Allah in many places.
Hmm.
The Prophet ﷺ made it clear that this intercession will not be for other than the people of Tawheed and Ikhlas.
Okay, brothers. It is no intercession except for those people who are on Tawheed and they are away from the shirk. Subhanallah. Okay? Hmm.
Important issues of the chapter.
Hmm.
Explanation of the verses mentioned.
Hmm. That is 4 verses. How many verses? 5. 4 out of 5.
1, 2, 3, 4, 6. 5. 6 verses.
So, this is, you read it. Explanation of these verses. We explain it. Okay, Shafa'a. These verses explain what is the Shafa'a, for whom, or how it is. This explanation is there, okay.
Description of rejected intercession.
You know, the intercession is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is related to the Jannah, Paradise, Akhirah, forgiveness. The intercession which is in the dunya, we are not talking about it. We are talking about which is related to Allah. No one owns it. Which is related to Allah. That is forgiveness. That is letting them to enter the Paradise. That is starting the accounts on the Day of Judgment. So it is owned by Allah. Other than that, Allah denied it.
No,
so no
one, right,
yes, no one can do all the intercession in these things. Mm.
Description of affirmed intercession.
Affirm intercession. It is with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First. Second. Illa liman irtada. For whom he pleases or likes. So these are the conditions. Mm.
The greatest intercession being the highest place of the Prophet sallallahu
alaihi wasallam. The greatest station, that is, you know, intercession. Highest intercession is when he asks Allah to start the accounting. Mm.
A description of what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will do on the Day of Judgment, and that he will not begin by making intercession, rather he will prostrate, and when he is given permission, he will intercede.
Okay. So he does not start. He goes and fell down, then it is when Allah orders, he starts. Okay.
Who?
The people are standing for more than 50,000 years, the day like 50,000 years. The people will be suffering and you can imagine. Then Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will go into sajda and then ask Allah to start.
Yes. Because they are the believers, they are the people of the Jannah, but due to not starting the accounting, they are also suffering. So, along with the others. So, when this accounting starts, so at least the people of the Jannah go in the paradise, so they come, and then the suffering comes to an end. So, that is why the Prophet has
said, everybody will suffer.
Everybody will suffer. Yes. SubhanAllah. That is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala angry on that day.
But that will be shade of the throne.
Yeah, only that is at that time, that is the shade of the throne is there. Shade of seven or in some ahadith, shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So only seven types of the people will get that shade that day. It happened that day. It's a lot of incidents that day. The shamsu kuvvidat, the nujum unkadadat, stars fell down, sun become, you know, dark. Many incidents happen. Very dangerous. Yawma tadhalu kullu murdiyatin amma anzat. The woman who is suckling, so he will forget his suckling baby. Wa kullu dhati hamlin. That the pregnancy, you know, pregnancy, pregnant people, they will, you know, abort their pregnancy. As if they are done. So that is the situation of 50,000 years.
The explanation what you are giving now is being recorded, so that you can record later.
Yeah, it is being recorded, you get it, inshallah. Yeah, you have the access, inshallah. Okay.
Who would be the happiest of people with the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
Who is the happiest person who get the intercession? Man qala la ilaha illallah khalisam min qalbi. The one who says la ilaha illallah with the sincerity, bottom of the heart.
Intercession will not at all be for whoever committed shirk.
So any shirk, no intercession. Please avoid the shirk.
Clarification of the real state of intercession.
Reality of the intercession means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, accept the, you know, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sajda, and then he allow him. So then he start the intercession. That is the intercession. Isn't it? That is the reality of the intercession. Not what we or some people they claim or they add. No, it is the reality. Okay? We continuously 2 hours we sat down. Do you want to continue till the azan or little bit? Yeah. Azan is 1 o'clock. So do you want to continue? You people are comfortable completely or? I don't have any problem. We can continue. But if you want, let us go continue, brothers. It's okay. Okay, go ahead. Bismillah.
Chapter 18. Allah guides whom He wills. Allah the Almighty said, "Inna kalantakadi man ajbatta ahbatta walakinna Allah yahdi man yasha'u wa huwa a'lamu bil muhtadin." Verily you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, guide not whom you like, but Allah guides whom He wills, and He knows best those who are the guided.
See here, guiding is of two types. Guiding is showing the way. إِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Oh, Prophet Muhammad, you guide the people towards the right path. So it is the showing the path. Oh, people, this is the path of Islam. Embrace, you will enter the paradise. That is showing. That is the guidance. One guidance is, you know, giving hidayah. That is the person's heart is turn towards acceptance. He accepts the guidance. That is the hidayah. So the prophet has the, you know, was given the power of showing the way, but putting in the heart and making them the hidayah, that means they accept the hidayah, that was not his problem. Isn't it? So prophet was Hadi Alam. He was the Hadi. Hadi means the guide of Alam, the whole world, whole universe, whole people. He was guide. But he is not having the ability to give the hidayah, to put the guidance in his heart so that he can accept it.
One is physical and this is by Allah.
It's spiritual.
Showing the way is
the, you know, physical. And the hidayah which is in the heart, that the people accept the truth, that is the spiritual. That is the iman. So here, Abu Talib was dying, his most beloved uncle. And Abu Talib was knowing that the Prophet is true. He said, "Inna khayra adyanil bariyati deena." The best deen of all the creatures is the deen of Muhammad. He said, "Inna khayra adyanil bariyati deenu Muhammadi." Khayra adyanil bariyati deenu Muhammad. Deen of Muhammad. He was knowing. Okay? So Prophet showed him the way, he knows the way. He knew the way, isn't it? But he did not accept it. That is the acceptance. Hidayah means acceptance of the guidance. So when Sadir this hadith, it becomes clear to you.
In the Sahih, Ibn al-Musayyib has reported from his father, by death approached Abu Talib, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to him and found Abdullah ibn Abi
Umayyah. So Abu Talib was near to die. So Prophet visiting him. So he found Abdullah ibn Abi Umayyah and Abu Jahl. So friends. Choose the friends, please. Aywa. Al-akhillahu yawma idhin ba'aduhum tiba'adhin aduwan illa al-muttaqeen. The day of judgment, the best friends will be enemies of each other, except so muttaqin. So righteous people's friendship will continue, not in dunya, even in the akhirah also. So be careful. Who are your friends?
Exactly.
Choosy. Be choosy in the friends. Dunya, so they will leave you here, they fight. The people, they will continue, beloved ones. Anyway, so Prophet went to his uncle because he is dying last time. Let us try. Because he was serious in guiding the people, so he never despaired of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He tried his best. So at the time of the death, let us see. He went. He got his two best friends, Abdullah ibn Umayyah and Abu Jahl. Let us see the conversation right now.
The Prophet said, "O uncle, say, there is no true God except Allah, a word which will enable me to plead for you with him."
Enable me to?
Plead.
To plead. Yeah. To plead for you.
With him.
Abu Talib, you know, what is wrong in saying la ilaha illallah? Only it is a repetition. He is going to die. Nothing. He does not have to time to perform, to break the, you know, idols. Nothing. He was saying, just saying la ilaha illallah. But he did not say. Why? He was understanding la ilaha illallah meaning.
He knew the meaning.
He was knowing what does it mean. And Abdullah ibn Umayyah, Abu Jahl also knowing what does it mean. Isn't it? La ilaha illallah means I become Muslim, I am no longer mushrik, I denied, I rejected my deen of my parents. That is the meaning he was understanding. So that is why he said, "Oh, please, sorry, I don't say that." So subhanallah. So right now, everyone says la ilaha illallah. They don't know as Abu Jahl and as Abdullah ibn Umayyah, as Abu Talib. They knew that, but they are kafir. And these are Muslims. Subhanallah. These Muslims, They say La ilaha illallah and they don't understand it, and they know the La ilaha illallah, that is why they did not say. Do you get the end point? Let us see.
Here it says to plead for you.
Yeah, once you say La ilaha illallah, that let us, then everything leave on me. I will plead. I will insist. I will, you know, request. I will cry in front of Allah. So I will try. But you say, then I will get the pun, you know, a clue, a proof, a excuse that he said La ilaha illallah. Oh Allah, he supported me. He is my uncle. He said La ilaha illallah. You can't leave him in the paradise. You can't, you know, punish him. That he wanted. Say La ilaha illallah Abu Talib once and die. Okay, that was the point. Plead. Okay.
The two of them said, would you forsake the religion of your father?
See here, they did not say, don't say La ilaha illallah. They don't say, don't become Muslim. They don't say, don't commit the shirk. They understood. La ilaha illallah, what does it mean? What does it mean?
Forsake your father's religion. Forsake the religion of your father.
La ilaha illallah means leaving all the religions. Leaving all the religions. Don't forsake, don't leave your father. The Prophet did not say leave your father's religion. The Prophet did not demand. What? The Prophet did not demand Abu Talib, leave, give up your father's religion. All the religions. He did not say. But they understood. What does it mean? Right now we are uniting, cooperating, compromising with, it's okay.
Except
cooking. Okay, go ahead. Don't forsake
the religion of your father, Abdul Muttalib. The Prophet repeated the request, and the two of
the page is not clear. There are copies. There are also copies. What's up?
You have the book. You read it. Give them. No. Take the mic. You read it.
6 point.
Here, here. Mic.
When death approached Abu Talib, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to him and found Abdullah bin Abi Umayyah and Abu Jahl in his company. The Prophet said, "O uncle, say there is no true God except Allah, a word which will enable me to plead for you with him." The two of them said, "Would you forsake the religion of your father Abdul Muttalib?" The Prophet repeated the request. And the two of them also repeated their question.
So Prophet is telling, say La ilaha illallah. They are telling, do you fast forsake your father's religion?
The final word of Abu Talib was being on the religion of Abdul Muttalib, and he refused to say La ilaha illallah.
He said, Ala millati Abdul Muttalib. He did not say La ilaha illallah. No, I don't say my father's religion.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, but I shall continue to pray for your forgiveness as long as I am not prohibited to do so.
He was knowing mushrik cannot be forgiven, but there was no ruling. Don't make dua. But Prophet was knowing what? The consequence of dying on the shirk. So he said, because there is no ruling, I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevent me.
It was then that Allah the Almighty revealed the verse, "It is not proper for the Prophet and those who believe to ask Allah's forgiveness for the mushrikeen, even though they may be of kin." So
even if they are your kin, your father, brother, sister, children, shirk, don't make dua, because khalas is no longer be forgiven because of the shirk. So this is the one ruling. The other thing is the Prophet was sad. Abu Talib, my uncle, long way, supported. No La ilaha illallah, and Allah is going to punish him. He was sad. So then the another verse.
So Allah also revealed concerning Abu Talib, "Verily you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, guide not whom you like."
You can't guide Muhammad. You don't have the power. You don't have the authority. You are not for that. Your job is only to guide the people, convey the message, not to put the guidance in their hearts. So no power. Okay.
Verily you, O Muhammad, guide not whom you like, but Allah guides whom He wills, and He knows best those who are the guided ones.
Okay. So right now we explain one with the words and the hadith. Important issues, let us see. We explain it, but Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab's style, let us see.
The important issues of the chapter. 1. Explanation of the verse. إِنَّكَ لَا تَحْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ.
So this is the verse, that Muhammad, you don't have the power to put the guidance in the hearts of the people. So that means, it is only Allah. It is the Prophet. So, difference of the creatures and the Creator.
Verily, you Muhammad, guide not whom you like, but Allah guides whom He wills, and He knows best those who are the guided ones. 2, explanation of the verse. مَا كَانَ لِلَّبِيِّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَسْتَغْفِرُوا لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ وَلَوْ كَانُوا
أُولِي
قُرْبَى مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُمُ أَنَّهُمْ أَصْحَابُ الْجَحِيمِ. It is not proper for the Prophet and those who believe to ask Allah's forgiveness for the mushrikeen, polytheists, idolaters, pagans, disbelievers in the oneness of Allah, even though they may be of Him, after it has become clear to them that they are the dwellers of the fire, because they died in a state of disbelief.
So as long as these people, they died on disbelief, whoever they are, fathers, mothers, kins, no dua for them, because it is decided, kafir, enter the hellfire. So what is the benefit of dua? So don't waste your time.
3, it is a major issue of the explanation of the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say la ilaha illallah, differing with those who claim to be possessing religious knowledge. They claim it is sufficient to be forgiven by merely uttering the kalima.
Those people, they understood, they did not utter. Those people, they came after, they uttered, they don't understand.
4,
that is why they say la ilaha illallah, they commit all kinds of the shirk, because they don't understand.
Abu Jahl and those who were with him knew full well the intent of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said to the man, his uncle, say la ilaha illallah, may Allah denounce the ones who were less knowledgeable than Abu Jahl regarding Islam.
Subhanallah. So these people who claim Islam, they are less knowledgeable than Abu Jahl. Because Abu Jahl understood the meaning of La ilaha illallah, that is why he prevented Abu Talib from saying La ilaha illallah. And it was understanding that you don't leave the deen of your forefathers. This La ilaha illallah means leaving the other religions.
5, the eagerness and intense desire of the Prophet ﷺ to convert his uncle to Islam. 6, the denial of those who claim that Abdul Muttalib and his forefathers were Muslims.
This is Shia.
The
Shia? What they say?
The denial of those who claim that Abdul Muttalib and his forefathers were Muslims.
Who claims? Abdul Muttalib and his forefathers were Muslim. Who claims?
Shia.
Shia and the Badalwis also. Because you know, the Badalwis means those people, the Sufi, extreme Sufis, Dargah people, they, you know, it goes the lineage, blood, isn't it? So father, then the Imam is his son, then Imam is his son, the Imam is his son. So how it can be possible that the eldest Imam, that is the Prophet, his father or his uncle, his grandfather is not Muslim, so it does not go with their principles. So they said, okay, they also embrace Islam. Sometimes the Shia claim that after the death, then the Jibril came and he, you know, raised him once again, he accepted Islam, then he buried. Shia and the Badalwis. Myths. Only to cheat the society. When the society may ask, see here, he was Imam. Why he is Imam? He's a bad person. That no, his father was Imam, so it comes from father to the father. Isn't it? For present people or for the previous people? So the common man asks, so if it is there, then the Prophet father was, you know, non-Muslim, and then Prophet uncle and his grandfather. So they say, no, they also embrace Islam. To match their principles.
7, Allah did not forgive Abu Talib despite the Prophet's initially asking forgiveness for him. On the contrary, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was forbidden to do so. Number 8. The harmful influence that evil companions can have on people.
Subhanallah. No doubt about it. Al-madhu ala deeni khaleelihi. There is a hadith. That the person is under the religion of his
friends.
So some people say, I have the relation with everyone. So it is not a criteria. Or it is not a credit. But you are the munafiq. That is why you have all types of friends. If you are secular. If you are very clear, you know that. Who is your friend, who is not. So with whom you have to spend the time. So Sufyan Sawri, rahmatullah alayhi, teacher of Imam Bukhari, he said, if anyone claims that he has, that everyone is pleased with him, then accuse him of his deen. Fattahimu fi deenihi. So his deen is not strong. That is why everyone is pleased with him.
A man who pleases all, he pleases none. Number 8, the harm of overpleasing ancestors and important personalities.
Once again, very important point. All the problems is due to the family, you know, and lineage, and you know, background, historical background. So, harm of what happened, you know, they overpraised the ancestors and their personalities, then started demanding them, then started depending on them, then starting worshipping them, or making the pictures and the photos and then worshipping, bowing in front of them. Isn't it? So that is what happened to Abdul Muttalib also, Abu Talib also.
Number 10, the argument of falsifiers are the arguments of Jahiliyyah, the Islamic period. Arguments of falsifiers are the arguments of Jahiliyyah.
What is that?
False aspect
of you before. These people justify also their falsehood by our ancestors, our, you know, religion, our, you know, elders. So the same argument. These people's argument is similar to the argument of Abu Jahl. Do you get it? So these people right now, if you go there, tell them this is shirk, that shirk, our elders, our sheikhs, our ancestors, our family, our forefathers. That is what they excuse. So what that Abu Jahl also, they did it. Instead of knowing the truth, accepting it, no, Millat Abu Talib. Millat Abdul Muttalib. No. In which matter do you follow the forefathers?
We say that if the Quran and the Sunnah is not very clear. I was trying to explain to my friend that when Quran is not so clear, and when they go to the Hadith scholars, and then they take it from the Sahabas, and if they not, they take it from other Sahabis, the concept. What he's trying to say is that you are taking from the forefathers instead of learning directly from the Quran. How can we explain that?
Brothers, this matter is always explained. Once again, I will explain it briefly, otherwise it needs a lot of, you know, explanation. Claiming that we understand the Quran and Hadith is 100% wrong. This is the foolish, insane people, jahil people, ignorant people. For understanding the Quran, you must have the complete, pure Arabic language which was existing at the time of Sahaba. So you don't have that language. So how do you claim that you are understanding Quran? You are understanding Quran in Tamil or English. So Tamil and English is the explanation of the translator. So you are depending on what the translator has understood. So this is the first mistake. Did you get it? Second thing is that when you say, I am taking from the Hadith, so you are not sitting down in front of the Prophet ﷺ. So you say that I am taking from the Prophet. So you are 1400 years away from the Prophet. You came after many generations. So the bridge, this gap between you and between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you need the senses of the hadith. So knowledge of the hadith that you don't have. So anyone who claims that I take from the Quran and hadith is a foolish person. So sooner or later he become atheist. He started criticizing everyone. So what the Salafis, they say, it is a simple. The Quran is explained by the Prophet sallallahu, isn't it? And what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained, that the Sahaba accepted it. Then the Sahaba explained to their tabi'in. What does it really mean? What does really it means? Because you don't know what is the word of zulm. You can't, you go to the dictionary and you explain the Quran and hadith. No, it is not the way. So then the tabi'in and tabi' tabi'in in 2, 3, 4 centuries, these people, when the pen and the paper and the, you know, writing become common, they recorded it in the books. That is Bukhari. Bukhari is nothing but those things that was memorized and narrated, he recorded. Isn't it? So what we want to say, that what is in the Quran, what is the hadith, the Prophet explained to the Sahaba, Sahaba explained to their generation. So we want to take it not by our understanding after 1400 years later. What they understood, that is what we want to take. So we are on the right path or they are on the right path. So they are understanding Quran and hadith and their understanding. Comparing the situation of the Prophet to this situation. For example, the hadith, the Aisha radiallahu anha. For example, there are many hadiths. Aisha radiallahu anha, the Prophet got married to Aisha when he was 7 years old and he consummated the marriage when she was 9 years old. So right now people are not able to digest it because they are comparing the situation of the women and the society today's to the what happened that time. When the Prophet got married to Aisha, no one criticized the Prophet. But all the society was ready to marry him, even 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, 20 years, no problem. Isn't it? And the Aisha itself, they did not object it. She lived very happily with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So who are we to right now to say that it was happened something wrong? If it was wrong, the people may have criticized that time itself. So such things are there. These people, they right now say the Prophet was the womanizer because he got married 11 wives. That time people used to get married hundreds of the wives. Prophet only married 11 wives, though he was the king and most respected people. So people praised the Prophet that time. Isn't it? Because he married less and he married all the widows with the children, with the aged people. Isn't it? So it was the, you know, great sacrifice and the great and, you know, good character of the Prophet. That is the non-Muslim, they accepted that time. They did not criticize the Prophet, you are doing something wrong. Isn't it? Abu Sufyan did not, he was fighting, but he said his daughter was got married, so he was happy that the very, you know, noble person got married to his wife, his daughter. So what I am telling here is the understanding. So these people who are claiming that they are understanding Quran and Hadith, they are the cheaters, they are the deceivers. They are deceiving themselves. They are misunderstanding Quran and Hadith. They can't understand the Quran and Hadith. They should understand what Ibn Abbas said about in al-hukmu illa lillah. Khawarij, they become Khawarij. They started fighting the Sahaba. Okay? Because they understood the Quran by themselves. So Abdullah ibn Abbas said, how many people? Oh, 6,000 people here. They gather in one place to fight Ali. So Abdullah ibn Abbas said to them, what happened to you, O people? I don't see anyone from the Ansar and the Muhajirin among whom the Quran revealed in your group. I don't see anyone. So are you understanding Quran better than them? That was his question. So no Sahabi was there with Khawarij. And these people, they say, Allah said, إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Whoever does not judge according to the law of Allah, he is a kafir. So Ali did not judge, so Ali is kafir, we are fighting him. So they are explaining by themselves. So Abdullah ibn Abbas said, how did you understand? Isn't it? Then he answered all these questions. So 6,000, 2,000 people, they repented and went with Abdullah ibn Abbas. That is the knowledge of Abdullah ibn Abbas. So he said, "Inil hukmu illa lillah." Why Ali made the hakam for two people when there was a disagreement? Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned, "Okay, do you want the evidence?" "Yes, okay, yes." He said, "Faman yaqtul," that is in Surah Al-Ma'idah, يحكم به ذو عدل منكم يحكم به ذو عدل منكم هديا بالغ الكعبة. Anyone who is in the state of ihram, he kills any hand, he should expiate. That expiation should be two trustworthy persons should decide. يحكمو. So Allah said, in a game, in a rabbit, in a chicken, two people will judge. So here is the bloods of the believers. So Ali asked two people to judge between them. So that is more serious or this is more serious? No answer. Then Allah said about the husband and wife. If they fight, حَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا إِنْ يُرِيدَ إِصْلَاحًا يُوَفِّقَ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. One hakam, one judge is from his family, one judge is from her family. So husband and wife matter is more important or the believers' lives are more important? No answer. So this is misunderstanding. They took one word, they left the other verses. So this is what happening to these people. Most of the time, they are self-understanding people, rationalists. So they are totally on the wrong way. Even they don't commit the tawheed, but not due to the Quran. Because rationally they accept that the tawheed is true. That is why they are following the tawheed. Not that it is the rule of Allah and the Prophet ﷺ. It is rationally they accepted it. So they are rationalist. So Salafi are those people who follow the Salaf. They don't follow them that Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, Imam Bukhari, what he said is okay, right or wrong. This is not the way. They take from them the explanation of the Quran and Hadith. Right now, what you are learning from me?
Understanding.
What you are learning from me right now? You are taking everything what I am telling you? Or I am explaining you the Quran and Hadith?
To their understanding.
So what I am explaining, that is you are taking. Why did you come? You take the Quran and Hadith, sit down in your house. Let us see, did you understand or not?
We can't.
Is it clear, brothers? This subject itself needs a complete workshop, but I wanted to make it a little bit summarized to you. Workshop is it is a modern style. Otherwise, it is the knowledge continuously sitting with the scholars, daily basis or the long way. So this is the way of knowledge. That is the workshop, isn't it? Because in 1 hour, 2 hours, you can't understand many things if you have a little bit longer time. So instead of having 1 day, 10 hours, it should be daily 1 hours, continuously whole life.
Yes.
Which is better?
Daily
is better. That is what the Salaf style. We are not able, so that is why we are doing this way. So if you are ready for that, it's okay. We can't do that because we should live in one place, we should, you know, have a common place, many things should be. Muslim society should be raised for that.
It will come.
Yes, isn't it? So that is the way. Yeah, that is what we have to think about it. Because without the, see here, later on goes that if there is no scholars, there is no truth. If there is no truth, there is then kufr and shirk. When there is a kufr and shirk, destruction of the society. Because the scholars, they play the role of prophets that we are going to learn. Sooner or later it comes after some chapters. So the problem of the society, no scholars. And we are not creating or we are not producing the scholars also. A huge problem. And you can see the influence of what happening right now. Because of not having scholars. And a scholar is not that he had some knowledge, it means he has the authenticity in his subject. No scholars means no truth. No truth. Isn't it? No truth. Everyone speaks whatever he wants. Quran and Hadith. He does not know any word of the Quran. He does not know any word of the Hadith. And then he is a leader of the Ummah, and he can guide the people. He can talk in each and every subject. It is long. Okay.
Number 10. The arguments of the falsifiers are the arguments of Jahiliyyah.
So arguments are the falsifiers. The people who are on the false right now, they are using the same argument which is used by Abu Jahl and I and Abdullah ibn Umayyah and the Kuffar of Makkah.
An attestation to the weight of the final deed in one's life, because had Abu Talib confessed, if that there is no true God but Allah, he would have been benefited by it.
So see here, till the end, when we are going to die, it is very important. We don't know when we will be taken away from the truth. So till the death, there is a hadith, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالْخَوَاتِيمِ. So a person was in, you know, in Olympiad, in Olympic Games. He was running first. But when the 1 centimeter, 1 millimeter was there, he fell down. So do you think that he is eligible for the gold medal or for the pure medal? So at the end, so we have to continue till the end. That is what we have to do dua always. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Continuous dua. We don't know, even 1 millisecond before the death.
Khairul khatima.
Aywa. Husnul khatima. Innama al-amalu bil-khawateem. Khawateem, the end. There is a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, the whole life a person does the good deeds, deeds of the people of the paradise. When one span of the one span distance of the hand is left, then he commits the kufr, and that's his, you know, his decrease comes, and he commits something, and he enters hellfire. The other person, whole life, he does, or he, you know, he does the actions of the people of the hellfire. When the distance of one span or one hand is left, that time he does the deed of the good deed and pious people, and he entered the paradise. Subhanallah. That is Qadar Allah, power of Allah. We don't know. We are very weak people. We have to repent and make dua. So khawatim. It is khawatim. Do you understand, brothers? So very important that always we think about that what we are doing is, we don't know when we will be taken away. That is why we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us firm and strengthen on the right path. مُقَلِّبَ الْقُلُوبِ مُصَرِّفَ الْقُلُوبِ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا وَاللَّهُ don't deviate our hearts anytime. Who knows? So that is why we should not listen the doubts. We should not listen the bad things. We should not look at the bad things. That is now, right now, all the people are in the doubts. Without knowledge, they want to answer the Christians, they answer the Hindus, they answer to, you know, defend Islam. They don't know Islam, they defend Islam. Let them to learn Islam, comparative religion. They are very fond of comparative religion because they feel that we are defeating someone. You implement deen, that is difficult for them. But they are defeating, or they are happy. Oh, mashallah, we defeated, we sleep. It is wrong. We need iman and taqwa. We don't need comparative religions. Maybe sometimes someone, once in millions, one people he needs to answer the doubts of the people. But generally the Muslim need that through Islam. And the general humanity, they don't need, except the, you know, the fitrah, the nature, the truth is explained by the natural way. That is more than enough. Okay? What did you say, boy?
That
a dirty, bad woman who was
very evil, at end,
when
he helped to a dog, gave the water, she went to
pray. It was not the end of the situation. It was not the end of the
situation. One, he gave the cat and he went.
It is not the end of the situation. It was the incident in their lives. Okay, there is sometimes we will leave you. After Zuhar, we will continue.
Just one.
Okay.
The consideration of the magnitude of this false argument in the hearts of the misguided, because in the story they did not argue except with it, despite the intense effort of the Prophet and his repetition of the Kalima. Because of their tremendous pride in ancestry and its distinction among them, they were content with it.
So they were content with the pride of their ancestors. So that is the important, you know, points of the story. So all these things, we should take the lessons from it and we should avoid it. And the people are doing the same mistakes which were done by people of Makkah. That is what Muhammad bin Abdullah want to highlight it. Okay, subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Inshallah, if the sisters have the questions, they may send it. We will answer the questions after Zuhur and then we will continue. He did not explain the hadith, he mentioned the hadith, that's it.
But how did the Sahaba understand?
That is the way, that it happened to anyone, anytime. So that is why we should fear Allah and ask Allah always, we die. لَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so La ilaha illallah should be your last word so that you will enter the paradise. Make dua always, fear. We don't know. Yeah, fear from your end. Make the dua. That who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let us to die on the truth. Let us to die on La ilaha illallah. آخِذُ كَلَامِنَا La ilaha illallah. So they used to make dua. They used to fear from their end.
The brother is mentioning
the hadith that one of the Sahabi severely fought, then you know he, when he wanted, he killed himself. So the Sahaba was telling that Fulanun fil Jannah, Fulanun fil Jannah, when his name was mentioned, so the Prophet objected it. How do you say that? So he astonished and he searched. Then he found out that the person, at the end, he killed himself. Okay, so that happened. We have to make dua always that our end should be at La ilaha illallah and according to the deen, the Islam. That is true. We have to fear from our end and make dua always. Okay? Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik.
الله ربنا هو الإله له من الأسماء ما اصطفاه الواحد الحي كذا المليك والملك المالك لا شريك الله ربنا هو الإله له من الأسماء ما اصطفاه